Thank you. Thank you. Well, welcome to the Mike Lazaridis Theater of Ideas here at Perimeter Institute for Theoretical Physics in Waterloo, Ontario, Canada. And welcome to this Perimeter's public lecture series. Now, my name is Greg Dick. I'm the Director of Educational Outreach here at Perimeter, and it is a pleasure to welcome everyone here. Those of you here in the studio, who I'm sure everyone online heard, they're wonderful, and those of you watching online, whether on Canada's, our Perimeter's website, or on one of our many science communication colleagues' websites around the globe. Now, the lecture itself will last approximately 1 hour and will be followed by a question and answer session. For those of you watching online, we have Dr. Stephanie Keating and a team of PI researchers behind the keyboards. They're monitoring the Twitter and the Facebook feed. Use hashtag PI Live if you want to join that conversation. And now, one special announcement before I introduce our special guest speaker. The Canadian government supports something called Science Odyssey Week. If you're visiting Canada, anywhere between May 6th and May 15th, we invite you to participate. It's a series of science, technology, engineering, and math events from coast to coast to coast. And if you're interested in participating, please check out the website for more details. And now, it is my pleasure to introduce tonight's very special guest speaker, Dr. Tim Palmer. Dr. Palmer is a Royal Society Research Professor at the University of Oxford and a Professorial Fellow at Jesus College, Oxford. Dr. Palmer was elected a Fellow of the Royal Society in 2011 and made a Commander of the British Empire in 2014. Among many national and international prizes, Dr. Palmer won the Institute of Physics Dirac Prize in 2014 for theoretical and computational physics. Over his career, Dr. Palmer has worked on applications of chaos theory from climate models to quantum physics. And tonight he will be speaking about his research on climate modeling, the emerging concept of inexact supercomputing, and chaos theory. Please join me in welcoming to the stage Dr. Tim Palmer.
Thank you so much. Well, thank you very much for that great welcome, and it's a real pleasure to be here today. I thought I'd just start with telling you about a phone call I got yesterday from a journalist from, I think it was the National Post here in Canada. And she said, would you do an interview for this lecture today? So I said, yeah, that'd be great, fine. So she asked me a question, and I have to say I've been asked lots of questions about climate change over the years, but this one I've never been asked before, and it kind of threw me back a bit. So it went something like this. She said, you're giving this lecture at the Perimeter Institute for Theoretical Physics. So I go, yeah, this is true. Yeah. The Perimeter Institute is a world-leading organization in theoretical physics. That's true, that's right. She says, well, you know, at the Perimeter Institute for Theoretical Physics, they have lectures on quarks, and they have lectures on cosmology, and they have lectures on string theory. Why would they have a lecture on climate change? So I'm going, That's a good question. And then I realized in a blinding moment that I knew the answer. And I realized that the answer actually provides a very good one-line summary of my talk tonight. So I'll give it to you. And the answer is, because climate change is a problem in theoretical physics, as I will hope to describe. I'm going to start by winding the clock backwards, almost 30 years, to a very famous, famous at least for us in the UK, weather event. A weather event that famously changed the town of Sevenoaks in Kent into No Oaks. It was a storm that was reckoned to be at least the worst storm that the UK has experienced, at least certainly southern England has experienced in over 300 years. But in terms of weather forecasting, it was actually infamous, because even the night before the storm, the weather forecasters were not giving any indication of anything severe or unexpected. just a slightly breezy day the next day. So I want to show you two weather maps for, it's actually not, this is not the storm itself. This is the weather map a couple of days before the storm struck. And the two maps, if you look at them superficially, they look very, in fact, they are very similar, but they differ very, very slightly. They differ by the fact that, you know, when we observe the weather from satellites or from surface observations, we never observe things absolutely perfectly. So what I'm going to do now is take a contemporary weather forecast model and take these two weather maps corresponding to two plausible initial conditions just a couple of days before the storm hit and run them forward in time with the computer model. So here we go. So they started off looking pretty similar, and they're sort of still somewhat looking similar. But now we head up into the morning when the storm broke. And you can see, you don't really have to know too much about weather, but when you get, these are surface pressure isobars, and when you get lots of isobars stuck together, then you know there's something serious is happening. And you can see the lower one has produced this vortex, which is about to track across southern England. And if I was to show you the winds associated with that, particularly on the southern edge, they would be close to hurricane force, which is actually what the happened. Whereas the top one you see is really shows nothing of any kind of severe weather. In fact, if one was a weather forecaster and looked at that map, you'd actually be predicting quite a nice day ahead. And unfortunately for these weather forecasters, it was the top maps that were produced at the time by the British Met Office. Whereas the if only the butterflies had flapped, if you like, at that initial time, they would all be heroes. And instead, they were castigated for being incompetent. I have to say, actually, these things are never quite as bad as they seem, because the head of the Met Office made a great pitch to government that they needed much bigger computers to do better initial work. So, bad forecasts, not always that. Anyway, what we're looking at here is a phenomenon called chaos. And it was actually discovered by the mathematical physicist Poincaré some years ago, but really made very concrete by the meteorologist Ed Lorentz from MIT, whose picture is there. And Ed Lorentz came up with these three equations. Now, you don't have to know what these equations are, but these are very simple differential equations. They're mathematically very simple differential equations. And in fact, these days, you know, when you run your computer in screensaver mode, you often see them produce sort of maps of these equations, because they're so, by modern day standards, so easy to solve. But anyway, what they show, and I'll show this animation now, of solutions of that set of equations, again, with two almost but not quite identical starting conditions. And you see that they track together almost perfectly for a while, but then diverge. So just the tiniest uncertainty in that initial condition has led ultimately to complete decorrelation of the time series. And this is pretty much what was happening at this in this severe storm in October 87. The atmosphere was actually incredibly unstable to tiny fluctuations. Let me just tangentially say that I think the most interesting aspect of Lorentz's work was actually to show that these equations generate a new type of geometry called fractal geometry in what's called the state space of the equations. And if I was giving a different lecture, I would tell you that Lorentz's equations made a bridge between the mathematics of Newton. Isaac Newton, who with Leibniz basically discovered the calculus, he would have actually understood very well what those equations were saying. But he would have had no concept at all about the geometric properties that these equations produce. And the mathematics underpinning this geometry comes quite close to contemporary mathematics such as the Gödel incompleteness theorem and some of the mathematics that Andrew Wiles used to prove Fermat's last theorem. So Lorentz actually is a remarkable character for making a bridge between classical mathematics and very modern mathematics. But I want to talk about a much more prosaic application of chaos theory, and one that is commonly used by those who are, let's say, unconvinced about the climate change threat. And the argument goes something like this. If you guys can't forecast tomorrow's weather, what hope is there for saying anything at all about the climate of the next century? So in particular, here's one of many examples I could have shown from the, this is the Telegraph, Daily Telegraph in the UK. This correspondent, Charles Moore, was reviewing a book by one of the climate skeptics, and the headline goes, "The game is up for climate change believers." Okay. And the commentary goes something like I've just said, you know, you might pay attention to tomorrow's forecast, but you wouldn't really believe anything much beyond a few days because it all goes wrong so quickly. And here's the bottom line. The theory of global warming is a gigantic weather forecast for a century or more. Therefore, it can have almost no value as a prediction. Okay, so I want to, to start by just addressing this question. And to do so, I could do this all in the context of Lorenz's model, and it would be quite nice to do that. But I'm going to take it down even to a simpler level and talk about this. This is the executive, I'm sure you've all got one at home or in your office. This is the executive decision maker. It's a magnetic pendulum that swings over these four little magnets. And as we'll see in a minute, the trajectory of the pendulum is very hard to predict because the trajectory depends very sensitively on where you started. And of course, the issue is to guess where the pendulum bob will finally come to rest. So if it comes to rest on the blue magnet, you buy 1 million shares in the company X, and if it rests on whatever. I'm told this is what they do in big business. So here we go. Place your money. You ready? I'll take the bets. Right, here we go. Whoops. No, we don't. There we go. Okay. So there goes the pendulum, and it looks like it's going to... it hasn't. No, it's gone off somewhere else. And it goes... And anyway, so you can see it's oscillating in a very unpredictable way. And if one was to track the pendulum and maybe repeat the experiment enough times, you'd find that, providing I've set things up properly, the pendulum bob should, on average, spend roughly a quarter of its time around any one of the four magnets. So they're all, as it were, equally likely. Now, if climate change really was about predicting the precise trajectory of the pendulum bob, then indeed, the Telegraph's correspondent would have been absolutely right. This would be a hopeless task. But that's not the nature of climate change. And to illustrate the nature of climate change, I'm going to do a slightly different experiment with with our magnetic pendulum by sliding this little wedge underneath. And we'll see what happens. So here it goes. So now I'm kind of tilting the odds. I'm changing the probabilities. Now the point, and this is an important point, the pendulum bob is still undergoing kind of unpredictable, chaotic oscillations. But you can kind of see it spending a bit more time under the yellow magnet than it is under the other ones. However, it does make these occasional excursions back, for example, towards the white magnet. But eventually, there it comes to rest on the yellow one. So there are two points to be made here. One is that in this particular example, what we're trying to do is predict the changes in the statistics of the occurrence of the pendulum bob under each of the magnets. I'm not trying to make a prediction about the precise trajectory. That is just as unpredictable as it was before. But what I would be interested in is how that wedge has changed the probability that the pendulum bob will be under any one of the magnets. And basically, this is the problem in climate change. The wedge is, as it were, our emissions of greenhouse gases and carbon dioxide in particular into the atmosphere. And the problem is to know how does that change the statistics of weather patterns? What weather patterns become more likely? Which ones become less likely? And what can we say? But there's also a second point to make, which is that as the wedge, as it were, slides under the under the pendulum. The system doesn't just respond in a completely kind of predictable or steady way. It's not in proportion to how the wedge is slid under. As we slide the wedge under, the pendulum is still oscillating in an unpredictable way. And even though we slid the wedge under, it occasionally does make those excursions back towards, say, the white magnet, which you could think, let's say, in this picture of climate, the white magnet could be the rather cold weather states, and the yellow maybe the warm ones, and maybe the red and blue are dry and wet or something. It doesn't really matter. But the point is, there isn't a simple kind of one-to-one relationship between how the system responds as the wedge is slid underneath. So if we look at something like the global temperature of the Earth over the last 100 years or so, we kind of see evidence of this chaotic variability superimposed on this gradual forcing. So this is data from the 19th century, pretty much up until the present day. And you can see, you know, there are periods in the 1940s to the 1950s where the temperature actually decreased systematically. But perhaps more relevant still to the present day is that you probably recall in the sort of late 1990s through into the 2000s, a lot of people were saying, well, this global warming stuff's been overdone. You know, the global temperature has hardly been changing. Nothing much is happening. I mean, it's clearly been overhyped. And us scientists were kind of, you know, a little bit frustrated about this because like the pendulum bob, we expect periods where it could even fluctuate back towards colder conditions. We can only say something concrete by taking a long enough time average, by averaging out these chaotic fluctuations. And so, of course, what we've seen in the last year, 2015, is a kind of a bounce back towards much warmer temperatures, and 2016 promises to be potentially warmer still. So in some sense, chaos doesn't, you know, chaos is definitely not a showstopper. Chaos doesn't mean that we can say nothing about the changing climate. But chaos does make us perhaps be cautious about expecting, as the carbon dioxide content of the atmosphere increases, for global temperatures to be rising completely in step. This would be an overly simplistic expectation, given this underpinning nonlinear chaotic structure that occurs in the atmosphere. So in some sense, chaos is not the primary reason why there is uncertainty, and as I'll talk about now, there is uncertainty in climate change, about climate change, but it's not really fundamentally coming from the fact that the climate system is chaotic. The real uncertainty, and the question, I said key question, I mean, it's literally the trillion-dollar question that we can't easily answer, is how big that wedge is that we're sliding under the magnetic pendulum. And just to be, you know, just to sort of make this point a bit more clearly, if the problem of climate change was merely about how the atmospheric temperature, for example, responds to an increase in carbon dioxide, you know, the changing radiative properties of carbon dioxide, which, well, just to summarize, being a greenhouse gas, is largely transparent to incoming visible and ultraviolet radiation from the sun, but largely opaque to outgoing infrared radiation, which is emitted by the Earth. If that was the only issue, then it would be a relatively simple calculation and one could be fairly certain about what to expect. However, there are many, at least potential amplifiers to do with the internal components of the climate system, which can potentially make climate change a lot worse, and in some cases could actually ameliorate, as I'll talk about in a minute, climate change. Perhaps the most important is water vapor. So I'm just going to briefly run through some of these so-called amplifiers. Water vapor is the gaseous form of water. So on a clear blue sky day, the sort of day you get in Canada, I guess, a lot, and a day we all rush outside and take our clothes off in England because we don't see see them that often. But even on such a day, there is plenty of water vapor in the atmosphere. And as the Irish physicist John Tyndall discovered back in the 19th century, in fact, water vapor is probably the single most important greenhouse gas in the atmosphere. So water vapor also has this property of being largely transparent to incoming solar radiation, which is why we see the sun very clearly, but largely opaque to outgoing infrared radiation. So water vapor acts as a blanket, trapping heat. Now, if you warm the atmosphere from additional amounts of carbon dioxide, that warmer air can hold more water in this gaseous form. And so that additional water vapor acts to amplify the amount of the direct warming from enhanced carbon dioxide. That, in a way, is a fairly straightforward amplifier, and I think one that most climate physicists feel reasonably confident about. Clouds I'll come onto in a minute, because clouds are the really big problem. Ice albedo, well, again, you're probably familiar with this idea that, for example, as the Arctic starts to melt, it exposes this dark water which previously was covered in ice. So ice, being high albedo, high reflectance, reflects the sunlight back to space. The darker water absorbs the sunlight, and therefore that sunlight is now acting to warm the climate system, whereas previously, by being reflected back to space, it was not doing anything. So again, ice is a potential amplifier. Things like methane you've probably heard about, you know, potential melting of permafrost can release methane. Methane, again, is a very powerful greenhouse gas. It has this, it's not as long-lived as carbon dioxide, so people argue about precisely what its impact will be, but certainly methane is an amplifier. And what's called the carbon cycle, this is the idea, for example, that as the oceans start to warm, they will be able to absorb less carbon dioxide than they currently do, and that will then tend to increase the amount of carbon dioxide that's left in the atmosphere. So again, that's a potential amplifier. I've left clouds till last, because clouds are probably, I would say, the single most important and least well understood aspect of climate change. Because clouds can act in two different ways. You're probably familiar with high-level cirrus clouds, sort of icy clouds very high up in the atmosphere. These are a bit like water vapor in that they can trap heat. You often, I don't know, I mean, certainly in the UK, you know, on an evening where the sky is clear and it looks, everything's set for a frost, and then you get this thin layer of cirrus coming over, and sort of, you can still see the stars and stuff through the cirrus, but you can tell it's slightly obscured by cirrus. Then on those situations, it's, you know, one often doesn't get any frost, in fact. So the cirrus acts as again, as a bit of a blanket. And in that sense, cirrus acts as an increase in cirrus level cloud from climate change will act to amplify, again, the warming. On the other hand, low level, the thicker sort of stratus cloud that sort of hangs down at a much lower level in the atmosphere, tends to have the opposite effect. It reflects sunlight back to space, and the sunlight is therefore not absorbed at the surface. So clouds are complicated. If the overall level of stratus cloud decreases, or the overall level of cirrus cloud was to increase, that would act as a positive amplifier of climate change. If the cirrus was to decrease and the stratus was to increase, that would actually act as a negative, sort of an ameliorating factor. I have to say, most of the models, and we'll talk about models in a minute, are suggesting clouds will be more of an amplifier than an ameliorator. But I have to say, the error bars are enormous, and this is perhaps one of the biggest areas of uncertainty, and something I want to discuss a bit more later on in the talk. So let's actually just talk a bit more about the real world. So here's an animation of the real world from space, looking at it from satellite. In fact, we're actually looking at infrared radiation from water vapor. So that the light colors actually show the blanketing effect of water vapor. And we can see, kind of superimposed on that, the chaotic, sort of quasi-turbulent nature of the atmospheric circulation. All those swirls and things are essentially the low-pressure systems, like the famous October 87 storm, that track around the northern and southern hemisphere. Those storms, incidentally, serve the purpose of transporting heat from the tropics to the poles. They're part of the thermodynamic engine of the atmosphere, where the heat that's built up in the tropics is spread northwards and dissipated. It's a very efficient way of transporting heat. So now I'm going to show you another animation from space, but now we're actually looking in the visible. So we're now looking at clouds, and we're looking in particular at the tropical Western Pacific. This is actually a region where the sea temperatures are warmest in the world, and where a lot of the moisture in the atmosphere originates from evaporation from the sea surface there. So we're looking down, and what we're seeing are bubbling thunderstorms bursting up in different places. And actually, interestingly, in this period, you see this typhoon. You can just see the eye wall of the typhoon. And another one actually forms as well. So there's a double typhoon, which is kind of an unusual situation. But on top of that, all the time, these thunderstorms just pushing up masses of air, of moist air, up into the atmosphere. And this is creating this blanket of moisture, which eventually spreads right around the world. So really being able to model clouds and so on depends crucially on getting some of this detailed structure correct. Let's see if we can move on. All right, so this is yet another animation, but we're now not looking at the real world, we're looking inside a computer. So this is a computer model of the atmosphere. And again, you kind of see something superficially, at least, similar to what we saw on the satellites. We see a kind of a turbulent atmosphere with these low-pressure systems, which in the model are doing the same job. They're transporting heat from the tropics to the poles, and doing it in a moderately credible way. So what are these models based on? And just to come back to my starting point, they're based on the laws of physics. And in fact, the three kind of principal laws, I would say, that they're based on are Newton's second law of motion, force equals mass times acceleration, Planck's law for the energy of a photon of a frequency omega, E equals h bar omega, Planck's constant, h bar. And that tells us how photons from the sun are absorbed in the atmosphere and how they're re-radiated back to space at much lower frequencies. And finally, that guy, I'm not sure if anybody knows who he is, I care to guess. His name is Rudolf Clausius, and he was the guy that invented the term entropy. Entropy is much used these days in theoretical physics. Rudolf Clausius. So second law of thermodynamics, again, a very fundamental part of simulating the climate system. So they all go into a climate model. It turns out, and maybe this is a surprising thing for me to tell you, the most difficult of those equations to solve is actually Newton's second law. Now, you might think, well, quantum mechanics is incredibly difficult to solve, but actually Newton's second law is much more difficult to solve when it comes to the climate system. So why is that? Well, here's Newton's second law written in a form that's relevant to a fluid like the atmosphere or indeed the oceans. And it's a form of Newton's second law called the Navier-Stokes equations, from Claude Navier and George Stokes, French and Irish mathematical physicists who wrote down this equation. Now, I'm not proposing to go through in detail what this equation says, but basically the left-hand side is mass times acceleration, and the right-hand side is the force. But with these, I don't know, 20-odd terms, I was meant to count the number of symbols, but it's around 20-something symbols, one can represent circulations in the atmosphere and the oceans from the very, very largest jet streams or Gulf Stream, the really biggest, big gyres, the big patterns with scales of tens of thousands of kilometers, right down to scales, actually right down to the my breath coming out of my mouth. These are all governed by this one equation. And just for the, if you like, cognoscenti, this equation is a non-linear equation because there are two terms here. This is u is the velocity, and they're multiplied together. And this might seem a rather innocuous thing, but when they're multiplied together in this way to give a non-linear equation, just as Lorenz's equations were non-linear, it means that all these scales from me breathing to the jet streams are actually all coupled together. This actually is the real origin of the phrase butterfly effect. It's actually not only about how uncertainties grow in size, but it's also about how they can propagate up from small to very large scales. So from a, from a mathematical physics perspective, the Navier-Stokes equations are really a work of art. So what are we going to liken them to? So maybe this Renoir, maybe? Actually, I'm going to liken them to this Russian doll. And the Russian doll is a very special Russian doll, because the Russian doll, like all Russian dolls, unpacks into small Russian dolls. But this one unpacks into a phenomenally large number of Russian dolls. Okay. And the reason for that, making that analogy, is that if you actually want to solve this equation, rather than just admire its wondrous mathematical beauty, if you want to solve it and get numbers out, you also must unpack it into its constituent components. And actually, if one solves this on a computer, it has to be unpacked into potentially billions of individual equations for all the individual scales. I would just say in passing, just to sort of characterize the complexity of this equation, its beauty notwithstanding, that many of the properties, the sort of basic, really basic mathematical properties of this equation are actually not known. And there's one of the famous million-dollar Millennium Prize problems from the Clay Mathematics Society still going begging, if you like, if you can prove that this equation has certain properties which nobody yet has been able to prove rigorously. So it's a wondrous equation, a very interesting equation mathematically. By the way, all this stuff on the board here is taken from some papers I was involved in trying to win that $1 million. By the way, which we didn't succeed. But anyway. You can read about it if you want to. Anyway, but if you want to solve this on a computer, this is what you have to do. It's unpacking the Russian dolls. The problem is that even the biggest computers in the world are just not big enough to represent all those scales from tens of thousands of kilometers right down to essentially the scale at which energy is dissipated by molecular viscosity. So what do? Well, we basically have to start chopping away Russian dolls. So here we are, we're chucking them away, chucking all the small ones away. And what we end up with is a model, and this would be a typical model that is used, for example, by the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, about which I'll say something in a few seconds, where you've retained scales from these very largest scales of tens of thousands of kilometers down to around 100 or so kilometers. Now, what that means is that the equations can actually describe quite well these weather systems which are transporting the heat north from tropics to the poles in the northern and southern hemispheres, because those have scales of 1,000 kilometers or so. But those thunderstorm clouds that were bubbling away in the tropical western Pacific and transporting heat and moisture and so on vertically are occurring on scales that are too small to be represented by the equation, in the computer, because the computer is just not big enough. Nevertheless, because these play such an important role in the climate system, we have to do something about representing them. And they're represented by, I use this with a little bit of trepidation because I'm sort of insulting some of my colleagues that spend their whole lives designing these things, but which are called subgrid parametrizations. But they're really very, very simplified formulae And they're really quite crude compared to the wondrous Russian dolls. But there are kind of crude ways of trying to represent these cloud systems. Something has to be done, but they're not being represented by the proper laws of physics. And in a way, this is the real reason why there's uncertainty about future climate. It's not so much to do with chaos, it's that we can't solve these Navier-Stokes equations sufficiently accurately to represent all of the important processes that go into climate and determine climate. So let's have a look at, we're inside a computer model, now looking down at the tropical Western Pacific. So let's have a look at what that looks like. And you can kind of see it looks more granular. It looks like a pointillist painting rather than the real thing. I mean, it has a kind of a stab, actually, at these cyclones. But they're actually, to be perfectly honest, they're rather pale imitations of the real thing. And you kind of have this sense that, okay, it sort of looks something like the real world, but it's not really the real world. All right, so what can we do about this? How do we represent the information from a climate model to government or to some maybe user group that needs to maybe know how to adapt to future climate change? I want to just come back, to answer that question, I want to come back to the October storm and describe how we deal with situations like this today in a modern weather forecasting centers such as the Canadian Meteorological Service. So this is what would go on in the Canadian Meteorological Service every day. And instead of running a single forecast, what we do these days is run what's called an ensemble of forecasts. We run 50 or maybe 100 forecasts with models varying, for a weather forecast, principally varying the initial conditions very, very slightly. And on many occasions, the atmosphere actually isn't that chaotic, and the 100 forecasts will actually agree with each other pretty well. And then the forecaster can go on the TV and express some reasonable amount of confidence in what's going to happen. But on this occasion, when we applied this technique retrospectively to the October 87 storm, and we're just looking 2 days ahead, it shows this phenomenal divergence in solutions. It illustrates how unbelievably chaotic the atmosphere was on that particular occasion. Now, what you can do is you can count up the number of these individual forecasts which had hurricane force winds tracking across the southern UK. It turns out it's roughly 30%. So in a modern day, in a modern day numerical forecasting office, if a situation like the October 87 storm happened again, what they would be able to say, they would still not be sure that it was happened, but they would be able to say there is a risk, there is a quantifiable risk of around 30% that we will see these types of hurricanes. Now 30%, if you remember the, where is it from, my Fair Lady? If you remember the saying in Herefordshire, Hartford, I'm going to get this right, Herefordshire, Hertfordshire, and Hampshire, hurricanes hardly ever happen. Did I get that right? If you just take that as your baseline, 30% is actually quite a large number. The chance of a 30% chance of a hurricane happening is actually extremely large compared to the sort of a priori probability. So at the very least, you know, if you had spent your retirement fund to buy yourself a nice brand new Lamborghini, you might be well advised, even though it's only 30% probability, you might be well advised to move it away from the oak tree outside your front door. And really, in climate change, it's very similar. What we do these days is run models, but we vary these unresolved representations, because we don't know how to resolve them. We don't know how to represent them precisely. In fact, there is no way to represent them precisely. In fact, in my own personal research, in my group, we're doing quite a lot of work to use ideas in random numbers, what's called stochastic mathematics, to actually represent the inherent uncertainty in these subgrid cloud and other types of processes. So the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change then collects together data from all around the world of these different models with these different subgrid parameterizations and comes up with graphs like this. So these are kind of probability projections, if you like, about how global temperature will change. Here, if we just continue with business as usual, emitting CO2 at the same rate as we're doing now, and here where we managed to get global agreement to substantially cut carbon emissions. This red, for example, is a kind of a this is not the maximum and minimum, but it's the kind of likely range of values. So by 2100, temperatures are somewhere above 2 degrees up to almost 5 degrees. Now, I don't know whether you're used to these numbers or not. It's a little bit, you know, two degrees, 3 degrees, 4 degrees, it doesn't carry much information. But suffice it to say that if temperatures rose by 5 degrees by 2100, this would be, this may sound rather alarmist, but this would pose a real existential threat to large parts of humanity, frankly. We would, you know, large parts of the world, which will get hot and humid, it will be hard for human beings to actually physically survive in the outdoors. So we're looking at catastrophe at one end, but we're looking at something which is probably manageable with some adaptation at the other end. And the problem is we don't know which of the route we're going in. I should just make one small point here. People often misinterpret this diagram as assuming that temperatures will rise in a very sort of uniform and steady way. This probability distribution hides the fact that individual trajectories kind of oscillate around in this chaotic way that I talked about before. So you shouldn't interpret this as meaning like this is the most likely median. You shouldn't interpret that the atmosphere will warm, you know, in this very uniform way. This is just the result of statistical processing. So this has come out of this 2013, what's called fifth assessment report from the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change. Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change is really just a group of scientists who, you know, who give actually quite a lot of their time to make these documents and try to give in as dispassionate way as possible the science of climate change. I wanted to so highlight, however, that, again, this problem of clouds is a crucial one. And one idea which, you know, is a might be a possible saving savior for mankind is illustrated by this figure here, which shows a cloud system or a set of sort of thunderstorms aggregating into one single big aggregated thunderstorm. And the important point about this is it's created around it a vast region of dry, clear air. Now, dry, clear air can radiate that heat back to space. So this could act as actually the big self-aggregation of cloud systems leading to large areas of clear sky around it could actually be a mechanism for ameliorating climate change, so for reducing this all these positive feedbacks. But in a way, we can't, you know, it's kind of frustrating that we don't know the answer, and we sort of have to understand this better. The Paris Accord last year was in one sense a wonderful thing because 190 odd countries signed up to they acknowledged the threat of climate change, but there's been a kind of a slightly maybe unexpected and less desirable consequence, which is that there is a kind of sense from a lot of governments now that they kind of feel, well, okay, well, we've done the science of climate change. We now just kind of move on to energy and adaptation and so on. And yet, as a physical scientist, I'm incredibly frustrated that we still have a very fuzzy picture on what our future holds for us. And as I say, I mean, this, you know, the fate of humanity does depend very much on how clouds respond to our emissions of CO2. And we really do have to understand this problem better. So how can we do this? Well, in some sense, what we have to do is get these cloud systems to be represented by the Russian dolls. By the way, just for the cognoscenti in the audience, what I call a Russian doll is a spherical harmonic coefficient. So spherical harmonics are ways of they're kind of wave patterns which you can project these equations onto. So we have these sets of waves, spherical harmonics. I'm being quite, in a way, precise when I talk about Russian dolls, just in case you thought I wasn't. So the question is, how do we get down to this scale where we can get down to maybe 100 meters, which would give us a very good representation of these thunderstorm clouds? How do we get there? Well, the answer is computers, eh? Who'd have them? Don't send, no? Sorry. the answer is... Okay, bear with me. The answer. It's blowing in the wind. Gosh, did I really talk about all this? Here we go. It's actually bigger computers. And I was encouraged last year that Obama has actually created a new initiative to accelerate supercomputing capability to produce, to move us into, in the early 2020s, the so-called exaflop era. So I just want to finish the talk, maybe take the next 10 minutes, just talk a little bit about some of the slightly more technical side about supercomputing, because this goes into this is part and parcel of the research that is needed to improve our understanding. You know, climate change is not like a laboratory. We can't just go into a lab and do an experiment which will tell us what climate change is going to be like. We can't really go back into the data, historical data, because we haven't really got a good analog of what's happening in the next 100 years. We can't solve these equations analytically. They're too complicated. So there is no option other than to do it with very high-level supercomputing. So hopefully in the early 2020s, we'll be arriving at the scale of what's called exaflop. So exa means 10 to the power 18 calculations per second. This is what a computer will be able to do. That's a phenomenal speed, I'm sure you realize. Let me just say a few words about floating point. You know, when we have a number, we can represent it by a kind of is that right? Yes. By a we can represent it by this array of digits here times some exponent, 10 to the minus 4. This is in a computer. We don't use decimals, obviously. It's all done in base 2. But basically, the idea is every number is represented by a series of bits which represent this sort of fractional part and an exponent. This is called a floating point number. And the default in scientific computation is to use 64 bits to represent each number. Now remember, we got sort of hundreds of millions of variables, so we're up to, you know, billions of bits floating around in a computer. And these bits take up energy. And energy, it turns out, is now the biggest constraint in moving forward from current supercomputing into this exascale era. Piece from the web says that this was actually a few years ago, where a big director of the Lawrence Livermore Computing Center was betting that we won't have exascale computers by 2020. But the reason he said that is quite interesting. Hitting exascale compute levels requires a fundamental rethink of virtually the entire computation process. One of the biggest problems standing in our way is power. Not just the power required to run a task on a central processing unit, but the power required to share the data across the chip, node, and cluster. It's theoretically possible to hit exascale computing with current levels of technology if you can afford to dedicate 100 megawatts of power to the task But the challenge is being able to bring exascale into the 20, say 10 to 20 megawatt range. If you remember, or if you think that a megawatt will cost you about $1 million a year in electricity, 100 megawatts is $100 million a year, which I don't think many computing centers can afford. So this is actually the key issue now about energy. And so from a computing point of view, a really important question is beginning to emerge. You know, for years we've used this default that every variable has a representation of 64 bits. This is the default. But the question which we're beginning to ask ourselves is how much real information are stored in the bits? And what we've realized is with the sort of theoretical structure of the Navier-Stokes equations, that actually, as you get down towards the truncation scale, as you get down to these really small Russian dolls, the number of bits of real information starts to decrease. So there are certainly 64 bits in the very large scales, but increasingly fewer and fewer in the small scales. So the question is, can we exploit that theoretical fact to make our computers and the computer models more efficient? This is leading me on to this topic of imprecise computing, which is the last part of my talk. So the idea is this, that if we think there are fewer and fewer bits of real information as these Russian dolls get smaller, then maybe if we represent the smaller dolls, the smaller spherical harmonics, which actually dominate the overall computational load, in some less than perfect way, using relatively small numbers of bits, the savings, the energy savings, would actually then allow us to represent more of the dolls. So this is a way to increase the actual resolution of the model. So there's a slightly kind of oxymoronic phrase here, which is that if you actually reduce the precision at which you represent these dolls, you can actually increase the accuracy of the model because it allows you to use that that energy resource to probe more into the smaller and smaller scales, and ultimately into these cloud scales, which are so important. So last year, I wrote a paper in Nature sort of extolling this kind of concept that we should move away from computers, which are, you know, traditionally following Turing and others, we think of a computer as something which gives a very precise and exact answer to a computation. But if this is costing us a massive energy overhead, it may be better to trade a relatively small number of precise computations for a potentially much larger number of somewhat imprecise computations. So I was promoting this concept of what I call energy-efficient heterogeneous architecture. Small numbers of very energy-intensive, high-precision processors, large numbers of low-energy, low-precision, and potentially non-deterministic processes. Just that last point about non-determinism. I'll skip over that to come back. On this point about non-determinism, there's a very interesting concept has been developed by a colleague of mine, Krishna Palem, at Rice University in Texas, where he has, this was actually originally thought of as a potential application in a mobile telephone doing kind of video processing, where you turn the voltage down across the transistors such that the transistors are no longer completely reliable on-off gates, and you get occasional errors creeping in. But for a lot of these, for example, video processing applications, it's hardly noticeable. So this is a type of chip which actually has this type of stochasticity, randomness in it. But you can run it at considerably lower levels of voltage and therefore use considerably less amounts of energy. And I mentioned to you that in the in these parameterizations which we're developing, we're actually building in this notion of randomness to represent the inherent uncertainty in the subgrid formulae. So this is a very nice potential application for a technology which would fit very harmoniously with this underlying mathematics. I'm just going to just slightly deviate from the topic of climate change for a second by asking whether there are any precedents for energy-efficient, imprecise computing. And I would argue, yes, it's actually us. And there's an interesting sort of paradox, I suppose, about us humans. We have 100 billion neurons in our heads, we have a signal processing capability of something in the exaflop range, and yet we can do what we can do, not with 20 megawatts, but with 20 watts. There's a factor of a million. So how does the human brain do what it does with such an incredibly small amount of energy? And when you talk to neuroscientists, you realize that many of these 100 billion neurons in the brain are actually at microscopic scales. They're right down at molecular scales. The axons which propagate signals, electrical signals, in the neurons, have diameters of just a tenth or so of a micron. And they're amplified by so-called protein transistors whose voltages are associated with ionic channels of just a few molecules. So for sure, we are subject to the noise, just as Krishna Palem's imprecise chips are subject to noise. And indeed, I would argue that this actually has some side effects which are quite positive. I think it makes us the creative people that we are. The fact that we, if you talk to great scientists about when they have their eureka moments, it's not when they're thinking hard about some problem and working in a very energy-intensive, deterministic way. It's when they're relaxing or doing something mundane, like, you know, catching a bus or something. That's when they have their moment of creativity. And I would claim that's when the brain is most susceptible to thermal and maybe even quantum decoherent noise due to these microscopic scales that are our neurons in our brain. So there may be some, as I say, precedents for this notion of calling imprecise computing. And just so I can keep the lady from the National Press happy, I would just say that actually this notion is applicable to subjects like cosmology. You know, if we've got any kind of multi-scale nonlinear system, like simulating a galaxy, for example, where we cannot represent explicitly all the scales that are relevant, this notion of treating very small scales in a more imprecise way, but an energy-efficient way, in a most effective way, is potentially a real way forward to get better understanding and better, more accurate solutions. Another example is turbulent flows inside plasmas, inside tokamaks, you know, trying to understand nuclear simulations of nuclear fusion. And then, of course, the brain itself. All right, so I think I'm done. So I'm just going to return to climate change and just finish with a topic which I guess is on everyone's mind. So what side are you on? Are you a climate change believer, or is it all a great conspiracy and a load of nonsense? I'd like to suggest that this is really not a good way to think about the problem. Fundamentally, as I said at the beginning, climate change is a problem in theoretical physics. There for sure are uncertainties, and as a result of that, we have to express our results in probabilistic ways, which means we're talking about risk. So the fundamental question is not whether you believe or don't believe, it's whether you think these estimated risks of dangerous climate change are large enough that it's worth taking some sort of mitigating action, i.e. cutting our emissions of carbon dioxide. You could view the problem a little bit like in making a decision about whether to buy insurance against burglary in your house. You don't have to believe that your house will get burgled. It's just that if you think the risk is sufficiently high and you've got sufficiently many valuable properties, you want to take some sort of mitigating action, then maybe taking insurance is a good idea. On the other hand, if you don't think you own anything of great value, or the insurance is outrageously expensive, then you don't take out insurance. But the issue is not about whether you believe or don't believe that your house will get burgled. It's a decision about balancing risks and costs. Now, in the case of insurance, I suppose it's a fairly sort of economic issue. With climate change, it's not quite as simple as that. There are moral issues and ethical issues and so on. But the science, all the science can do is go as far as saying, this is what the risks are, these are what the probabilities are. We move away from theoretical physics into the real world, and it's the world of politics and the world of ethics and morals and so on, and economics, in whether or not we actually do want to take that step towards mitigating the effects of climate change. So let me just sort of summarize that then in a few sentences. If you ask me, as a scientist, is the world warming? I will say undoubtedly it is. If you say, is it due to human emissions of carbon dioxide? I will say almost certainly it is. If you say, will our continued emissions of carbon dioxide lead to dangerous levels of climate change? Well, if we can agree that dangerous means probably something in excess of 2 degrees of warming, I will say it seems quite likely that that will happen with any unmitigated emissions, continuing emissions. If you ask me, will cutting our emissions reduce the risk of these dangerous levels of climate change happening? I will say yes. That seems to be quite a robust aspect of the science. But if you ask me, should we therefore cut our emissions of greenhouse gases? I will say, well, that actually is not a question that science can dispassionately answer. It involves disciplines which physical scientists are not necessarily expert in. And so I will say to that question, answer the question, that is for you to decide. Thank you very much.
All right, I'll open the floor now to questions. In studio, if you have a question, make your way to the microphone and we can form a queue behind the microphone. And I see Aiden. Aiden, you're up.
So, you know how you can take an image and represent it as a group of tons of pixels. So, couldn't you make a simulation of the environment by having somewhat connected pixel, like you're doing it on the small level and then making them connect so that you don't have to do all of your calculations as many times? And can I add something? Because you mentioned fractals, I'm pretty sure. And I know that clouds behave like fractals, so wouldn't the pixelate idea work?
Well, you have to come and work in my group. That sounds like a great idea. As I say, we're sort of ultimately, what determines how to solve this problem is not the pixels as such, it's these underlying equations. And we have, maybe somebody will come up with some new idea about how to solve these equations. You know, maybe one day quantum computers will find a way to solve these equations in ways in which, our conventional supercomputers can't. So it's kind of difficult to, these are things that are hard to predict. But the nature of Newton's laws of motion just make this a very, very complex problem. And it's basically because all these, if you like to call them pixels, these scales are interacting with each other. You can't kind of separate the problem out and say, well, I'll just solve for the big parts and I'll just, throw away all the small parts. These are all interacting together. And you have to take this very holistic view where all of them interact together.
Like, the pixels are connected, so you're doing quite small scales, and then you're letting them sort of mingle up, like they're connected,
right?
So that you don't have to do it and like also run the big scales and sort of intermix the two things?
Well, you know, there's a whole field, a discipline called numerical analysis, where people try to decide what is the most effective way to try to solve these equations. And there are many, many different ideas, many different approaches to solving these equations. And maybe your idea will work out one day, who knows? Keep at it.
Thank you, Aidan. Let's go to the online questions. So I have a question here. It says, how much does human activity affect the formation of cloud types from high absorbing to low and reflective, and the amount of water vapor in the atmosphere?
Yeah, I mean, you know, the thing about water vapor, I would say the answer is relatively a small amount. I mean, the water vapor, you know, comes basically from evaporation in the oceans, and the oceans cover most of the Earth. So we, you know, our direct emissions of water have a small effect, but they're really insignificant compared to the natural source, which is the world's ocean. So they dominate matters. But of course, what we're doing indirectly, what we're doing indirectly through our emissions of carbon dioxide is increasing that evaporation of water from the ocean. So we have an indirect effect, a big indirect effect on water vapor, but the direct effect is less big. I mean, there, you know, people sometimes worry about contrails from jet planes and whether they can have an effect. I'm not convinced that's a strong effect. One other thing to say with jet contrails is, this is quite an important point, is they're very transient and temporary. You know, if we ground all the jets, you know, the contrails go immediately. Carbon dioxide in the atmosphere, on the other hand, is a very, very, very long-lived species. Once we stick a molecule of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere, it'll be there for hundreds or thousands of years. So these are different types of problems.
Thank you. Let's go in studio here.
You may have already answered my question. I was going to ask if anybody's figured out how to use quantum computers for this particular problem.
I think the answer at the moment is no. I had a very interesting email just a couple of days ago about somebody who works in quantum computers that was very excited about this idea of imprecise computing, and there may be some synergies there. At the moment, the range of algorithms that are genuinely faster on a quantum computer are somewhat limited, and as far as I'm aware, they don't yet extend to solving equations like Navier-Stokes. But again, it's like the other question. It's hard to make a definitive answer about this, because it requires is some piece of ingenuity to realize a kind of an algorithmic approach to something like Navier-Stokes that could be applied to a quantum computer. So as yet, that I don't think exists, but there's no proof that it doesn't exist either. So we have to, people have to work at it, and hopefully one day something good will happen.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Let's go in studio again.
Oops. Thank you very much. Wonderful talk, very clear on the uncertainty involved. I was particularly fascinated about the issue of clouds, and it seems to be very problematic in terms of figuring out what to do. I belong to an organization called 350.org, and 350 is the number of parts per million we used to have. We're now up around 400 and change. But basically, of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. The aspiration is to get it back down. I don't think that's going to happen. But there are approaches, which I think are probably pseudoscientific, but for example, of introducing vast amounts of particulate matter, the way volcanoes do. I think hydrogen sulfur, not hydrogen, a compound of sulfur.
Sulfur
dioxide. It sounds dangerous to me in itself, but is a problem figuring out what that would do? Is that it sounds even more complex than your cloud issue. Would you agree? And I'm just wondering if it is in any sense responsible to be considering this. I mean, it's not irresponsible, it is worth considering, but it seems pretty problematic.
I agree with you, absolutely, it's extremely problematic. And people often cite, as you say, spraying sulfur dioxide into the stratosphere, which creates these sulfate aerosols, they reflect sunlight back to space, as if that is a complete countermeasure to global warming. But you have to remember that the problem of of greenhouse gas emission is a problem to do with trapping of the infrared energy from the surface, and that is not physically the same as reflecting more visible sunlight back to space. Now, where this mismatch will potentially create issues is in trying to understand not so much the direct sort of global temperature, but what happens to the water cycle? What will happen to the monsoons? What will happen to, what will happen to the moisture that feeds the rainforests? It's quite conceivable, for example, that you might end up choking the supply of moisture to the rainforests, which would then stop absorbing carbon dioxide, and you would inadvertently have increased the level of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere completely in the opposite direction. So the potential for unforeseen consequences is enormously high, and I'm not a great fan of, it's fine to do the research, but to propose this in any serious way as an alternative to cutting emissions is kind of mad, in my view.
I totally agree. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I'm going to go with one last question, and I get to pick it because I have the microphone. You dive deep into quantum foundations, and you have your day job as a climate physicist. When did you know that they were both your passion? How did you find your way into this?
I tell you actually a story about this. I mean, I did my PhD in general relativity theory under a very famous cosmologist called Dennis Sharma. And one of Dennis's students turned out to be quite well known. His name is Stephen Hawking. And Dennis was very excited when Hawking discovered that black holes evaporate quantum mechanically. He was very excited because this was a great result, but he was very excited because here was his student doing this great stuff. And I was actually a student at the time, PhD student of Dennis's, and he came into my office one day and he said, "We've got to understand Hawking's result better. I think the secret is to apply principles of thermodynamics, and in particular, a concept called principle of maximum entropy production. I think if we can get to grips with the principle of maximum entropy production, we'll have cracked the black hole, evaporation. Palmer, you get onto it." So, so I'm going. But wait a minute. The story hasn't finished. I never heard of this thing, so I had to, read up books and everything. And I got myself into a mess, couldn't really figure it out. But anyway, I became a kind of an expert on the principle of maximum entropy production. Anyway, towards the end of my PhD, I had an option. I had a career path. I was offered actually a position in Hawking's group, and I was seriously thinking of taking it. But a colleague of mine said, you want to think about, have you ever thought about some other things? Maybe doing something a bit more societally relevant, like climate. I said, "I don't know anything about climate." He said, no, talk to this guy. I've got this friend of mine who's a climatologist. Just talk to him. I wasn't that keen on the idea. But anyway, I went along. I said, "Look, I don't know anything about climate, so just, I don't know, if you can tell me something." He said, "Look, there's a very exciting idea that's just come about in climate science that we can try to understand pretty much everything to do with climate. It's called the principle of maximum entropy production. My God, you know, 2 weeks ago I'd never heard of this damn thing, and then suddenly it was So I got into the field in a very unpredictable, chaotic way, in a way. I was seduced by the idea that this principle, actually it turned out that I don't think it's been particularly useful for either black holes or planets, but nevertheless, it got me my first sort of foot in the climate door. And then I thought, well, this is actually quite interesting stuff, and it does affect people's lives, and people do want to know about it. So that's how I got into it.
Ladies and gentlemen, a true pleasure, Dr. Fong.
Thank you.